فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
In his own fihrisit al-awsat, that he did exactly what Al-Imam al-Khatib al-Baghdadi had done. And he read it in three majalis, three sits. So it's possible, it can be done. But as I said last time, we try to look at these people through our own weaknesses. When we're looking at these imams, we're really looking at them through who we are. And that's not what they are. They're greater than us. They're fast, and their reading is fast. Naam.
قال الذهبي في التاريخ الإسلام وهذا شيء لا أعلم أحدا في زماننا يستطيعه.
الإمام الذهبي was talking about his time. الإمام الذهبي died in the year what? 748. 748. الإمام الذهبي. His name is محمد بن أحمد بن عثمان ابن تيماز. And Imam al-Dhahabi is from Turkmenistan, right? He's Turkmani, originally. But he was born and raised in Dimashq. Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah. Imam al-Dhahabi, the books he's written are so much. Just on Sirah and Tariq and Kutub al-Rijal, he wrote more than 150 books. Just on Sirah, forget Hadith. Forget all the other fields, forget qira'at and whatnot. Just on tariq and seerah and tarajim, he wrote 150 books approximately, or just over it. Dhahabi was shocked at the type of people he was with and the people whose time he resided in. He saw that no one was able to do what Khatib al-Baghdadi was able to do. And you have to look at the time he's talking about. He says, وَهَذَا شَيْءٌ, and this is a matter, a thing, لَا أَعْلَمُ أَحَدًا فِي زَمَانِنَا يَسْتَطِيعُ. There is no one at our time who's able to do this. People have lost aspiration, dead. بِاللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ, today if I said to you two brothers, we're going to do class today till Isha, who would stay? Everyone will find a reason to go. يَا أَخِي وَاللَّهِ مَا مَمْ. Yeah, my mom, she called me right now. Apparently, only today is when you want to listen to your mom. Sah? Everyone find a way to leave. I just have to go and check my car if it's in a safe place. And yeah, welcome back. Ahdahu, aspiration is dead. Now.
رحم الله أبا عبد الله كيف لو رأى
أبا عبد الله.
عبد الله كيف لو رأى همم أهل هذا الزمان ماذا يقول. وكان أبو محمد بن التباني أول ابتدائه يدرس الليل كله, فكانت أمه ترحمه وتنهاه عن القراءة بالليل, فكان يأخذ المصباح ويجعله تحت الجفنة شيء من الآنية العظيمة ويتظاهر بالنوم, فإذا رقدت أخرج المصباح وأقبل على الدرس.
Al-Imam Abu Muhammad ibn Tabban, he would study when he was young, his first early stages of seeking knowledge. He would study at night. يَدْرُسُ اللَّيْلَ كُلَّ, the whole night he would be studying. This is something the Salaf used to do. Studying at night, all of it, they would do that. He would. فَكَانَتْ أُمُّهُ تَرْحَمُ, his mother would have mercy on him. He would have mercy on him. وَتَنْهَاهُ عَنِ الْقِرَاءَةِ بِاللَّيْلِ, and she would prevent him from reading at night. You know, mother, your blood's going to finish. Your eyesight's going to go. How are you going to do this to yourself? Always has rahmah and mercy and kind. Who's going to look after you? Who's going to give you food? How are you going to sleep? Where are you going to sleep? Send me a picture of where you're staying. Ah. She always wants to show you, huh? Who's sleeping in the masjid? Who is sleeping? You're sleeping. Does your parents always call you, show me, FaceTime me, let me see, huh? Always worried. Abu Muhammad ibn Tabban, awwal ibtida'ihi, his first stages of seeking knowledge, what would he do? he would seek knowledge all night. فَكَانَتْ أُمُّهُ تَرْحَمُهُ. His mother would have mercy upon him. وَتَنْهَاهُ. She would stop him from it. Go to sleep. عَنِ الْقِرَاءَةِ بِاللَّهِ. He wants to read at night. The reason why she would stop him from it is different from why we would be our situation. How is it slightly different? فَكَانَ يَأْخُذُ الْمِصْبَاحَ وَيَجْعَلُ تَحْتَ الْجَفْنَةِ. Back in those times, people would have to use a lamp. And that lamp was fire, smoke would come out of it, and it would go into the eyes of the person, and the person would have to breathe in the dark smoke. And it could cause something to your lungs, have an early death. And many of the ulama died because of this. This was many of the causes of the scholars. There's a risala written on those scholars who died due to their recitation and their reading was why they died. No other external illnesses. Just because of either excessive reading and they lost their eyesight, it affected them. Or reading in the sun. Because back in those days we have houses like this, but their houses were made out of straws and things like that, so the light would always come in somehow. It would rain. They would have to protect their books and everything. So his mother would be worried for him. Are you going to be all night here sitting here smoking in the... Switch it off. Go to sleep. We have lights. And still we don't find somebody doing that. Press a button. Sit down. The whole room is lighted. Sit down. Just read. No one benefits from it. If you say to that person, come let's play games right now. His eyes. If he wanted to sleep, he wakes up. Garaba. And he's very young. Look at awwal ibtida'ihi. This is the early stages. This is the early stages. يدرس الليل كله. All night he wants to study. فكان يأخذ المصباح ويجعل تحت الجفنة. He would take the what? He would take the lamp when his mother tells him stop. You know, moms, they've got control. So what he would do is he would sneak the lamp. He would place it under a big, what do you call it? A vessel. Something very big, he would place it inside there. And then he would read. So the smoke, and he's overcome what his mom say. And he's still able to study. And he would hide it from his mom. وَيَتَظَاهَرُ بِالنَّوْمِ. So when she comes, he would pretend he's sleeping. فَإِذَا رَقَدَتْ أَخْرَجَ الْمِصْبَاحِ. Whenever she would, إِذَا رَقَدَتْ بِمَعْنَى إِذَا نَامَتْ. If his mother goes to sleep, he would wake up. وَأَقْبَلْ عَلَى الدَّرْسِ. And carries on reading. Hours are like that. But for what? Facebook. All day. His mom comes. He goes back to where he was, the chat and the conversation that he was in, right? Hadahu, this is different. This is how serious and how tough they were when it came to seeking knowledge at a very old young age. وَأَقْبَلَ عَلَى الدَّرْسِ. نعم.
وَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ فِي بَعْضِ الْمَجْمُوعَاتِ الْخَطِّيَّةِ فِي مَكْتَبَةِ النَّجْدِيَّةِ خَاصَّةٍ مِمَّا يُنْسَبُ إِلَى عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ بِنْ حَسَنْ آلِ الشَّيْخِ صَاحِبِ فَتْحِ الْمَجِيدِ قوله شمر إلى طلب العلوم ذيولا وانهض لذلك بكرة وأصيلا وسل السؤال وكن هديت مباحثا فالعيب عندي أن تكون جهولا.
The author now brings a statement. He says, وقد رأيت I saw في بعض المجموعات الخطية في مكتبة النجدية خاصة مما ينسب إلى عبد الرحمن ابن حسن آل الشيخ صاحب الفتح المجيد قوله. He said, وقد رأيت I saw في بعض المجموعات, in some of the compiled treaties, some رسائل that were written and compiled, but these were before they were printed, they were handwritten. So he said, I saw it as a خطي, handwritten. When it was what? Is it called parchments? Huh? Manuscripts, huh? He saw it when it was in that state. مما ينسب إلى عبد الرحمن بن حسن آل الشيخ. And this was attributed to عبد الرحمن بن حسن آل الشيخ, who is the grandson of Muhammad عبد الوهاب. He is the one who explained the Kitab al-Tawheed, Fath al-Majid. He wasn't the first to, before him was Sulaiman ibn Muhammad. Sulaiman ibn Abdullah ibn Muhammad Abdul Wahab, who explained it and he called it Taysir Aziz al-Hamid. But he died not finishing it. If he finished it, his one would have been better. But what happened was, AbdulRahman ibn Hassan took his cousins, their cousins. This one's called AbdulRahman ibn Hassan al-Shaykh. Al-Shaykhiyah means what? What does al-Shaykh mean? The family of Muhammad al-Abraham. Shaykh al-Shaykh, the word al-Shaykh, when you hear it, it means al-Muhammad al-Abraham. Al means family, the family of Muhammad al-Abraham. That's what it means. So here, Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan ibn Muhammad ibn Abdullah is his name. And the other one is called Sulaiman ibn Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Abdullah. They're what? They're first cousins, right? They all come together on Muhammad Abdul Wahab. Muhammad Abdul Wahab is their granddad, both of them. Their fathers are brothers. Hassan and Abdullah are brothers. They are two sons of who? Muhammad Abdul Wahab. Both of them explained Kitab al-Tawheed. The first one explained it was who? Sulaiman. He called it Taysir al-Aziz al-Hamid. And then he didn't finish it. He died whilst writing it. He got shot and killed by the leader of Egypt. Al-Basha, he came and he... back the gunpowder guns, when they came out, they lined them all up. And it was from those who were killed. Dhulman wa udwana. He got shot and he got killed. Then Abdul Rahman ibn Hassan, he then explained what Kitabu al-Tawheed, he called it Fath al-Majid. Very powerful book, very amazing book, scholarly written, well organized. In that, not in Fath al-Majid, but he's the author of Fath al-Majid, in those rasa'il, the author saying I just saw, but now it's published. وَقَدْ وَقَعَ فِي كُتُبْ مَطْبُوعَاتِ. Some of his written books, especially if you go to Majmu'u al-Rasa'il wal-Masa'il al-Najdiyah, if you have it at home, look at the third volume, it's somewhere in there, I don't remember the page exactly. But in the third volume, somewhere I saw it. So it's actually in some of the published books right now. These lines of poetry. And this line of poetry is written in the qafiyah, and the form and the structure of Bahr Kamil. Bahr, the Bahr is written in, it's called Bahrun, Bahr Kamil. The author says, شمر إلى طلب العلوم ذيولا وانهض لذلك بكرة وأصيلا وصل السؤال وكن هديت مباحثا فالعيب عندي أن تكون جهولا شمر. ما معنى شمر؟ The word شمر normally comes from is to lift up. When a person back in those days they wore a thobe, صح? Or they wore a izar, right? So if you wanted to really run, what would you do? You have to lift it up, right? And go. So shammir, it means lift the bottom of your garment. Ila talab al-ulumi, but run to seeking knowledge. Dhuyulan is the lower part of the garment. This part is called the dhuyul. Or the ending, walidalika, the tail of the animal is called a dhail. What's the tail called? A dhail. That's why when scholars write books, they call it ذَيْلُ طَبَقَاتِ الْحَنَابِلَ. ذَيْلُ. ذَيْلُ means the book is finished and you always add a little tail to it. Does that make sense? Al-Imam Abu Ya'la al-Farra, when he finished his book, his طَبَقَاتِ الْحَنَابِلَ, he wrote scholars of the Hanbali Madhab, he's missing some because the Hanbali scholars still carrying on, right? Are you with me? It has to carry on. So Ibn Rajab came and he done a Dhaylu Tabaqat al-Hanabila. He added a tail to it. Somebody now can come and call it Dhaylu Tabaqat al-Hanabila. Can add more to it. Until today, all the Hanabila that need to be added onto it. Are you with me? Sir Alami Nubalat, somebody can put a Dhaylu on it. And it goes on. So, Dhuyul, that's what it means. Shammir ila talabil ulumi Dhuyula. Lift your lower garment towards seeking knowledge. One hub, get up. لِذَلِكَ بُكْرَةً, get up, morning. وَأَصِيلًا, in the evening, get up for it. وَصِيلِ السُّؤَالَ, connect the questioning, meaning ask continuously of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also even ask knowledge about it. وَكُنْ هُدِيتَ مُبَاحِثًا, and be a person who is seeking and searching. Mubahat means searching. فَالْعَيْبُ عِنْدِي Deficiency to me is أَنْ تَكُونَ جَهُولًا For you to be ignorant. That's something to be embarrassed about. To say, I don't know something. It's embarrassing in the sense where if the person's been striving hard, then حَاطَّةُ لِلَّهِ To encompass everything, it's impossible. It's what? It's impossible to encompass everything. And if you say, I don't know, after studying for so many years of your life, then that's honorable. And that you've been putting all your time and your effort in. To say, La adri is nisful ilm, is praiseworthy here. When scholars say, La adri is nisful ilm, that doesn't mean when you say La adri twice, you got full knowledge. Nisful ilm, boom, I got full knowledge. Huh? Some people said that. But what it means is that, what? La adri is nisful ilm, is half of knowledge. It means, that once you know you don't know, all that's missing from you is now to go and embark on it. Because you've admitted you don't know. The problem is the one who thinks he knows. That one has a long way to go. It's called jahlun. Jahlun murakab is a compounded ignorance. First of all, you have to pour that out of him to first educate him. Because if he believes he knows, it's a problem. This is one of the ghurur and the deception shaitan does to people who seek knowledge. A talib ilm, student of knowledge, is always in need of seeking knowledge. You may be a friend of another person, a brother. You know he's better than you in a field. He knows this field better than you. You don't know it as much as he does. Arrogance would overcome you to sit in his halaqa. Wallahi, I used to see my mashayikh. One sheikh is teaching. And then the other sheikh is sitting there listening, taking notes. And then when his class comes, he will sit and the other one will sit on the floor and he will take notes. Like that. Today, a student of knowledge, he studies something, goes to a prestigious university, you know, he goes to university, goes to this university. He comes back. That's it, khalas. I finished knowledge. I'm not going to sit with anybody. Yaqi, maybe the country you've come back to, there's somebody that might know something you don't know. He might even be younger than you. He might even be a person you taught once. Humble yourself. If you're serious about seeking knowledge, and this is what it's all about for you, you shouldn't be arrogant in sitting down and learning from them. There's some people, wallahi, today, I personally would sit down and study from them. I would love to. I would take knowledge from them. And they're younger than me. I saw them grow up. I would sit down with Sheikh Jamal Abdel Nasser. You guys know him? He's a Qari, young boy. I would sit and take Quran from him and learn from him and make him listen to my makharij and my pronunciation of the Quran. Even if it's in a circle that there are hundreds of people, it doesn't bother me, it doesn't concern me. Because I need it. And if you hajjat in ilayh, if I hold myself from it, I am not harming anybody except who? Except myself. His knowledge is not going to go. And it's not going to perish. You're the one who's going to lose out. You're not harming anyone when you say, I don't want to go to his halaqa. I'm not going to see in his lesson. He's not going to be having any harm. You're not harming him. إِنَّمَا تَضُرُّ نَفْسَكَ You're only harming yourself. You're the one who's going to walk around ignorant and not know how to read the Qur'an properly. صح? نعم.
فَكُنْ رَجُلًا رِجْلُهُ عَلَى الثَّرَى ثَابِتَةٌ وهامة همته فوق الثريا سامقة ولا تكن شاب البدن أشيب همة فإن همة الصادق لا تشيب.
The author now brings a statement which he doesn't attribute to anybody, but this is an iqtibas min qawli Ali ibn Abi Talib. It's a statement he took from Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali is the one who said this. Ali ibn Abi Talib is the one who said this statement. فكن رجلا بي أيمان رجله على الثرى ثابتة. Be a person or be an individual. رجله, his foot. على الثرى, his foot is on the earth. ثابتة, but it's firm on the floor. وهامة همته فوق الثريا سامقة. And his head, وهامة means head. the head of his aspiration. So the head of a person, if your legs are on the floor, then your head, which is aspiration, is high in the sky. The word thuriyya in the Arabic is a star, but it's not every star, it's the highest star. I don't know what it's called in English. I once knew it, I forgot it. It's a type of star that's up, that's the highest. The Arabs, they use that one. Huh?
North star.
Huh?
The North Star.
The North Star. Is it when you go up north? Yeah, it's used for a particular direction. It's the North Star, huh? So that star is the one that they say. It's the highest star. Be you a person whose legs on the ground firm, and let your head be high up in the sky. And it's exactly like قوله تعالى أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٍ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. That's how you should be as a person. Your legs are in the ground, solid, and you're high up. You're grounded and you're rooted. This statement, he took it from who? Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali said this. Ali said, فَكُلْ رَجُلًا رِجْلُهُ فِي الثَّرَى وَهَامَةُ هِمَّتِهِ فِي الثُّرَيَّى. فَكُلْ رَجُلًا رِجْلُهُ فِي الثَّرَى. Be a person whose leg is on the ground, strong, rooted. وَهَامَةُ هِمَّتِهِ فِي الثُّرَيَّى. And the head of his head of aspiration should be high above. وَلَا تَكُنْ and do not be شَابَّ الْبَدَنِ أَشْيَبَ الْهِمَّةِ. Don't be a person who's got a young body, but his aspiration is old. The reason why he said أَشْيَبْ, first of all, the word أَشْيَبْ is a وَصْفُ لِلْرَجُلِ إِذَا خَالَطَهُ الشَّيْبِ. أَشْيَبْ means, it's said and it's used when a man, not a woman, a man, age mixes, he becomes aged. يُقَالُ لَهُ, it said أَشْيَبْ. And you should not say, and it's wrong to say شَايِبٌ. It's very common in the Arab world, especially when you travel to Saudi Arabia, they'll say شَايِبْ, شَايِبْ. غَلَط, that's wrong. Even فُصْحَة, some people use it as it's incorrect, لُغَةً. Some لُغَوِيِّين, they say it's strong, but it's weak, it's not strong. Whereas the woman, when she becomes old, they use the word شَيْبَاء. That's how it's said. So the word أَشْيَبْ is مُخْتَصٌ بِالرِّجَالِ, specific for the man. The woman, شَيْبَاء can be said to her, and also the word شَمْطَاء. شَيْبَاء can be said, or شَمْطَاء. Both can be said. The man could also be called, if the words, the woman's called شَمْطَاء, that form for the man would be أُشَيْمِطْ. As for أَشْيَبْ, this usage that the author is using here, أَشْيَبُ الْهِمَّةِ, is مَخْصُوصٌ بِالرَّجُلِ فَقَطْ. It is specific to the man only. So the author said, وَلَا تَكُنْ شَابَ الْبَدَنِ. Don't be a person whose body is young. أَشْيَبَ الْهِمَّةِ. But he's old in his aspiration. What he means by he's old in his aspiration is that when a person becomes old, what happens? They become weak. They become what? They become weak. So the person is going to become weak in his what? In his aspiration. His aspiration is very tired. When a person becomes old, he becomes fatigued and tired quickly, and he sleeps early quickly, and everything just becomes slow and everything. This is due to what? It's due to old age. It's all due to what? It's due to old age. So the person should know, should not be, sorry, a person who is young. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith al-Imam al-Bukhari narrated in Sahih min hadith Abi Hurairah, لا يزال قلب الكبير شابا في اثنتين. That a person's heart would always remain young, even if he's old. He will always remain young in his heart with two things. Two things is always still young. He doesn't change from that. He's still like a shab in that. And that is حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَطُولِ الْأَمَلِ. Loving the dunya and loving a long lifespan. This is something every single body likes. If you go 70, 80, and a 10-year-old, they're all the same on this. Everyone wants to live for long, and everyone loves the dunya. Some of the riwayat, it says, حُبُّ الْمَالِ, loving wealth. That's something everyone is the same in. Everybody loves money. The amount is different, like in. Some people just simple. As long as it pays the bills, that's all that matters to me. Others, no. I have to have leftovers. And it's shocking because, I don't know if you guys heard it, but what's it called? The man who first created a bulb. They said he tried it for how many times? 999 times. Have you heard this before? That's how many times they said he tried it and he tried it and he tried it. And on the 1,000th time, he got it right. This is how it works. That's a person whose qalb is still young. Just keep this going. He does not take no as an answer. Then the author carries on saying,
كان أبو الوفاء بن عقيل أحد أذكياء العالم من فقهاء الحنابلة ينشد وهو في الثمانين ما شاب عزمي ولا حزمي ولا خلقي ولا ولائي ولا ديني ولا كرمي وإنما اعطاد شعري غير صبغته والشيب في الشعر غير الشيب في الهمم.
The author, he says, كان أبو الوفاء بن عقيل. Ibn Aqil, who is أحد أذكياء العالم من فقهاء الحنابلة. He's from one of the, this sentence which is called, that he brought, which is أحد أذكياء العالم من فقهاء الحنابلة. This is called in the Arabic language, جملة معترضة. Meaning, if you take out the sentence, there's nothing, it's going to, there's a wording for it in English. When you're doing essay writing, and you bring a sentence that's got nothing to do, وما أنسانيه إلا الشيطان. Let's always blame Shaytan. Yeah? Shaytan is the one who made me forget. It's his fault. We would have been in Jannah. We would not have forgotten anything. What would we have? We just would have been in Jannah. كان أبو الوفاء ابن عقيل أحد أذكياء العالم من فقهاء الحنابلة. Ibn Aqil was from the smart scholars, and he was from the jurists of the Hanbali madhab. He was a jurist from the Hanbali madhab. يُنشِد وهو في الثمانين. يُنشِد is the khabar of كان. The يُنشِد is the khabar of كان. So the all of the other is what? جملة معترضة. وهو في الثمانين, and he was in the age of, his age was 80. He was 80 years of age, and this is the poetry that he put forward. Oh, this is what he said. ما شاب عزمي ولا حزمي ولا خلقي ولا ولائي ولا ديني ولا كرمي. ما شاب عزمي. My intention has not grown old. ولا حزمي and my decision. ولا خلقي and my manners. I'm still young in all of that. All of that, I'm still young. I'm still young in my intentions. Still sharp like I was when I was young. وَلَا حَزْمِي, my decisions, I'm still strong and tough on it. It hasn't grown old. وَلَا خُلُقِي, and also my manners and my character. You know, when people grow old, what happens? Become moody and everything, it hasn't changed. وَلَا وَلَائِي, and my love and allegiance. My love and allegiance has not also died out. Sorry, it hasn't grown old. Still young and fresh in my love and my allegiance. وَلَا دِينِي, my religion hasn't also become old, it hasn't wore out. I'm still strong on my religion like I was when I was young. وَلَا كَرَمِي, and my generosity. Because when a person grows old, what happens? They become a bit stubborn. Elderly people start to become a bit stubborn. They can't see a reason to give it out anymore. They believe, Somalis, they have a saying, they say, لِحْدٍ جِرْ يَلَّ حَوْسِ جَعِلْ. لِحْدٍ جِرْ means 60, when a person reaches, every single thing he starts to keep it in the house. Parents just don't want to throw out anything. Mom, throw this out, it's been here for the last 20 years, we don't need it anymore. No, you don't know, there's going to be a time that you're going to need it, you're going to know. They just don't want to throw out anything. 60, everything around them become, they become too attached to it. Their car is broken, that's still like it. You can't get something out of their hands. No, don't, no. 60, when you see, you'll see, start to see those characteristics of yourself. That's when you need to get worried. That's when you know you need to be worried. That's what's happening. 60. Who feels like his parents are like that? That they just don't want to throw out anything. The house is becoming clumps and it's just filling up. Yeah? Yeah? Your parents are like that. Don't worry, I won't tell your parents. It won't be in the recording, inshallah, as well. Don't worry. Yeah? If you're scared that your mom might hear your voice inside the recording, yeah? You say, hey, my mom's like that. Yeah? Then the author goes on to say, وَإِنَّمَا اَعْتَاضَ الشَّعْرِ غَيْرَ صِبْغَتِي. The only thing is that my hair changed from a color other than its color. وَإِنَّمَا اَعْتَاضَ اَعْتَاضَ means what? It comes from the word عِوَض, to change. شَعْرِ, my hair changed. غَيْرَ صِبْغَتِهِ, it changed into a color of other than its original color. What did it used to be? It used to be black. That's the only thing that's changed. That's the only thing that's growing old, my beard. My manners, my etiquettes, my enthusiasm, my decision, what do you call it, my love allegiance, my religion, my generosity, that's still young. It's just my beard. وَإِنَّمَا اَعْتَاضَ شَعْرِي. My beard, on the other hand, it changed. غَيَّرَ صِبْغَتِهِ, in other than its original color. وَالشَّيْبُ فِي الشَّعْرِ غَيْرُ الشَّيْبِ فِي الْهِمَمِ. And the whiteness in a beard is what? Is different. The age in the beard is different from the age in the aspiration. The age being old from your beard is different from being old in your aspiration. And when ذلك الشيخ الألباني رحمه الله, it was mentioned that what he used to do was, and he used to say to his students, he used to say at the age of Albani, died at the age of 83, 84. And then he never used to miss the Monday and the Thursday fasting. And the students would miss that sometimes. And they would say, look at me, I'm old. I'm very old and I'm still able to fast Monday and Thursdays. You guys are young. But the answer is, وَالشَّيْبُ فِي الشَّعْرِ غَيْرُ الشَّيْبِ فِي الْهِبَمِ. Age in the beard is not necessarily the age that a person has in their aspiration. We'll stop there, inshaAllah ta'ala, for the kitab شَرْحُ تَعْظِيمِ الْعِلْمِ. We'll carry that on, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. We're now going to go back. We're going to now go to, inshallah ta'ala, the book, Thalathatu Usul. I'll give you guys, inshallah ta'ala, 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, we'll go back to, we'll start Thalathatu Usul to finish it all off in one sit, inshallah ta'ala.